So we say that the Muslims are, they are impersonalists, they don't accept God as a person. So what is the destination of those who follow Islam? Okay, see, whenever we classify, generally we get some simple framework of classification. Say for example, this is black and this is white. But then we learn in between there are many shades of grey. So similarly, Islam has a, you could say, somewhat peculiar conception of God. We generally talk about the idea that God has form and God is a person. Those who consider this are personalists. And God does not have a form and God is not a person. Those are the, who are they? Impersonalists. So now Islam has a strange idea that God is a person but he doesn't have a form. Now how that works out, that is difficult to, how do you conceive personality without form? That's something difficult to understand. Now again, if you consider any religion, it's, see, the scriptures might say one thing, but there are many different interpretations also come up. So one thing with Islam is that they are not just, they don't accept God as a form, they are militantly against depicting God in any form. One of the books I have written is Idol Worship or Ideal Worship, where I talk elaborately about why do we worship stone images, and why are some religions so much against it. If you have read or heard a little bit of Indian history, how many Islamic invaders, when they would conquer any place in India, they would destroy the temples and desecrate the deities. And this is not just in the Quran, it's not just in Islamic history, it goes back right to the Old Testament. Old Testament is the sacred book of the Jews. So there also, whenever any king would conquer any place, the first thing they would do is they would go and destroy all the false, the word they use is the false god that were being worshipped. So the idea over there is that, see, because God is up here, he is transcendental. And they have, in all these religions, one thing that is common is they don't have any description of how God looks like. And that's why in some of their depictions, God is depicted like an old man with a long beard. This is of course Christianity or Judaism, inspired by the Old Testament. But basically there's no description of God that is available in these traditions. And that's why any description, any depiction of God that comes, that has to be based on imagination. So if there is God and we have no description, if anybody is depicting, that depiction will be imagination. So God is here and there is some depiction over here. Now their understanding is that because this depiction is an imagination, so then they feel that you may think that this depiction is reminding you of God. And in that sense it is useful. But in general, people, because they can see material things and they can't see the non-material, so they will soon get so captivated with the depiction that they will forget the divine behind the depiction. And in this way, the depicted idol will become become an enemy of the divine, will become a competitor to the divine. So you could say that this is a means to the divine, but it will end up becoming the competitor to the divine. And anything that is a competitor to God has to be destroyed so that the glory of the one true God can be maintained. So that's why they are militantly against any worship of any, as they say, graven images. So that is more a historical phenomena that has emerged from the specific kind of revelation or lack of revelation within their tradition. So in Islam also there have been especially Sufi saints who were very devoted to God. And Sufism was more like a, you could say, an amalgam of bhakti from the Hindu tradition and some of the aspects of Islam. But overall, again, you could look at Islam in broadly three ways. It is at that time, at an individual level, Islam is a way by which many people live a more pious life than they ought to have otherwise. They do their namaz, they do give their charity, they go to Mecca, they follow some kind of regulation. So at an individual level, it is a way to piety for many people. And there are many teachings within Islam which do help people to develop this piety. But in general, one of the major differences between Islam and other religions is that there is a mixture of the spiritual authority and the political authority. If you see other religion, in our tradition, we have Brahmana and Kshatriyas are separate. Brahmanas are the spiritual authority, the Kshatriyas are the political authority. So you, now with Buddhism, it started with Buddha, but it was spread especially by Ashoka. But again, there is a separation of spiritual and political authority. Jesus was a spiritual authority. If you want to consider anyone a political authority, that will be Constantine or one of the Roman emperors who spread it. And but in Islam, Muhammad was both the spiritual authority and the political authority. And Muhammad fought many wars also. And in some of the wars, see, wars are brutal, and sometimes strategies are used in wars which are not the best strategies to use. So what happens is that when the war took place, now everything that Muhammad did can be cited by subsequent Muslims as something that they can learn from, something they can model on. So generally, at an individual level, Muslims look at some of the spiritual teachings of Muhammad and some of his examples of how he lived spiritually or ethically. But whenever it comes to a Muslim congregation or Islam as a political force, then the political leaders of Islam quote the political, the example of Islam as a of Muslim or Muhammad as a politician. And there is where a lot of brutality is rationalized in the name of Islam. So Islam, for at an individual level, it can be a religious path to a more pious, a more virtuous life for people at an individual level. But at a political level or at a social level, it often becomes a political search for power. And these two strands are very strongly mixed together. Because at one level, the individuals combine together to become the become the whole. And the whole is led quite often by people who quote Muhammad's political example. So whereas now if we consider terrorism or extremism, which is advanced in the name of Islam, there are two ways of looking at it. One is to just whitewash Islam and say that these are just a few fringe extremists and it has nothing to do with Islam. To say that Islamic terrorism has nothing to do with Islam is one extreme. The other is to equate Islam with Islamic terrorism, or Muslims are terrorists. Now both of them are wrong. To equate Muslims with terrorism is a horrifying misrepresentation, because in today's world, every fourth human being is a Muslim. If every one of them were terrorists, the world would be completely on fire. It's not like that, definitely not. But the other politically correct way is to say that Islam has got nothing to do with Islamic terrorism. In fact, Barack Obama was strongly criticized because for all the IS violence, he refused to word the Islamic terrorism also. He would just say right-wing terrorism or something like that, Middle East terrorism. So now, is it derived from Quran? Is the Islamic terrorist violence derived from Quran? See, a book is ultimately a book. How somebody interprets a book depends on the leaders at that time. So now, there are sections over there which could be used to interpret extremist kind of violence. And is that what Quran teaches primarily? No. But is that a teaching that can be derived from Quran? Yes, it can be derived. And now when that teaching is derived, what happens is that if you consider Islamist extremist violence, the biggest victims of that violence are Muslims only. It is in the Middle East, so many people have become refugees, so many people have been killed. So this aggression, all aggression is unfortunately, they're in all religious histories, you could say. But because of the mixture of the political and the spiritual, Islam is more vulnerable than other religions to be used to foment extremist violence among people. And overall, I have been to interfaith conferences. I was in Washington DC recently, other interfaith conference. One of my Muslim friends, he told me that he said, it is easier for me to communicate with moderates of other traditions than extremists of my own tradition. So we try to simply oversimplify and say, oh, these are Muslims, these are Hindus, these are Christians. You know, Islam is a very big thing, just like Christianity is a very big thing. Hindus, there are all kinds of Hindus are there. So, you know, we have to see people as individuals and see, so there are moderates in Islam, there are extremists in Islam. So basically, just like we talk about the Renaissance that happened in Bengal, I talked about when modernity encountered the Western Indian tradition. There was similar Renaissance in Europe around the 16th, 17th centuries when Christianity encountered the modern times. And that Renaissance led to a reformation to some extent. But unfortunately, Islam has never had that kind of Renaissance or reformation. So how Islam is to interact with modernity, there has not been a collectivized movement which will reshape Islam. So individual Muslims might navigate that on their own, but overall, for many people, if they are devoted to Allah in their own way, now devotion to Allah can also be in different ways. If somebody thinks that devotion to Allah means that I destroy innocent people who when interpreted against God, now that is tamasic, that is in the mode of ignorance, and that is going to be destructive. But if one is devoted to Allah and lives a more pious life, lives virtuously and chants the names of Allah, then they will be elevated. Again, to what extent elevated will depend on their individual consciousness. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah. Okay. So if our faith keeps going up and down and we are not able to surrender, sometimes we hear something from materialists, sometimes we have some less than pleasant dealings with devotees, and then our faith goes down. So how can we surrender if our faith is wavering? See, Krishna consciousness has multiple aspects to it, and it is very important to differentiate between what is central and what is peripheral. Or you could say there are heart doubts and there are head doubts. So the central aspects, okay, that I am not the body and the soul, that God exists, that Krishna is the most attractive vision of God, especially sweet vision of God that is available in the tradition, that bhakti, the path of love, is the way to approach God. So these are, you could say, some fundamental tenets. So if we have doubts about these, then we have to put in a substantial amount of effort to get them addressed. If we treat all aspects of Krishna consciousness to be equally important, then it's like faith in one aspect, when a doubt comes about one aspect, the whole edifice might start shaking. It shouldn't be like that. We have to be clear what is central, we have to be clear what is peripheral. That means, say, there are many different aspects. Say, in the Bhagavatam, there is a description, for example, that Maharaj Chitraketu, who is one of the kings described, he had a large number of queens. Now, that is a huge number. Now, is that a literal number? Or is that just indicative that he had a large number of wives? The main point of the story is that although he had so many queens, he could not get a son. And even after that, how many of you know the Chitraketu story? Okay, half of you. Okay. And I won't go into telling the story. Basically, he was a king and he wanted a successor for become the next king. And he married many, many, many times, but he could not have any child. After that, he was in great lamentation, and at that time, a sage blessed him, he would have a son. He was called Harshishoka. The son was there, he became very joyful. But the other queens who did not have a son became envious of the queen who had the son, and they poisoned the son. And then he was killed, and then he was disconsolate again. The same son who brought him happiness brought him distress. And the sages came and enlightened him. Don't be so attached to worldly things. And then he became spiritually inclined. So this is a simple story. This is a broad story, a simple outline of the story. So now, in this story, it is described that he had something like 10 million queens he had. That's what the Bhagavatam says. Now, can anybody have 10 million queens? Now you may say, how is that possible? Now, is that figure literal? Is that figure symbolic? Now, some people may say that it's literal. Now, maybe, you know, he tried and tried and tried and it didn't work out. Some people say, it's indicative that he tried a lot. That he tried a lot to have a child who he couldn't have. Now, this figure, what is the central message of the story? Is the central message of the story that this king had this many queens? That's not the central message. The central message is that despite sometimes some material happiness might just not be there in our destiny. And no matter how much we try, we can't get it. So he tried with so many queens, he could not get a son. Finally, the sages arranged for a son, but the son died. Basically, he didn't have the happiness of having the son in his life. So sometimes in the material world, certain happiness may just not come. That's the main thrust of the lesson. Of the story. So now this detail, some people may say that it's no, that's how it is. It's given the Bhagavatam, you have to accept it. Some people say the Bhagavatam is a poetic work. And in poetic work, certain things might be explained through an emphasis which might not be literal. Now both positions are acceptable. So what happens is that if you consider Krishna consciousness, there are certain things you are central, and as you move away from the center, there are many things on which there can be multiple stands. Maybe it is like this, maybe it is like this also. So we have to be clear about the central aspects and be committed to the practice of the central aspects. So as far as the other peripheral aspects is, it is quite possible that based on our experiences, our frame of mind, our kind of questioning attitude or whatever, we might not have the same kind of faith that others have on that particular issue. That's okay. Our intelligence, or you could say our reasoning faculty, reason or logic. On the spiritual path, our logic should be our minister, not our master. Minister means it's like a king has a minister and the king takes advice from the minister. So like that, we shouldn't just accept anything which is illogical, then because it's told in scripture, it's told in tradition, so accept it. So use your logical intelligence to understand things. But there are some things which if we understand, if God is supreme, then that means God is superior to my intelligence also. And my logical faculty is a part of my intelligence. So some aspects of God may be beyond my religious capacity to understand, my intelligence capacity to understand. So there is illogical, there is logical, and there is translogical. Something which is beyond logic. It's not below logic, it is above logic. So we treat logic as our minister, not our master. When you have this attitude, then you will make sure that you will that there are certain things which I can accept right now, and this is the foundation of my faith. And certain things, well, maybe I need to get a clearer understanding of this. Some things, it's not that we reject them, but it's something you can say, I suspend judgment about them right now. Till I get more knowledge, maybe I ask more proper, more devotees who are learned in the subject, and I might get some understanding. So whenever we have some doubts, you could say that doubt is like a quake. It's like an earthquake. I was in New Zealand, and I was sitting there, and suddenly I was giving a class, and suddenly I saw everybody was moving in the class. And then I realized I was also moving. So then it realized, struck me that actually there was a minor quake that had happened. And they say that in Wellington, I was in Wellington. So Wellington, Auckland, Christchurch. So in Christchurch, they have the maximum earthquakes. So now, say if I'm sitting here and a quake happens over there, okay, the ground will shake, a little tremor will come to me also. But if the quake happens right here, then the tremor will maximum. So you could say that the doubts are like quakes, and they will cause tremors within us. So if the core principles of Krishna consciousness are where our faith is centered, then that will be a foundation where there will be no quakes. If quakes happen over there, over there, over there, somewhere, yes, it's a quake, I'll be a little shaken, but not much. I think you have to find an anchor there. I talked about earlier about the anchor. Waves will come and we have to find an anchor to hold ourselves to. So this will be like waves. They will come and you have to find an anchor. So it's not, I won't say that what you are saying is not an issue of faith. It's more an issue of commitment. It's more of committed practice. And find one thing which you can be serious about. Make sure that you commit yourself. This is what I will do no matter what happens. And gradually through that connection, purification will happen, the connection, some satisfaction will become, and so that connection, stability will come, and then you can expand that connection. So that's how we can move forward. So how did evil people get human body if they have a lot of bad karma in the past? So there are different kinds of bad karma and different kinds of reactions because of bad karma. Broadly speaking, the reactions can come in three ways. That if you have done some bad karma, you might go into an animal body, a lower species. That's one kind of reaction. Another kind of reaction is we might go into a lower planets, hell or other planets where there's greater distress than here. And the third is we could be in this body itself, but in this world we get suffering. Now, it's not necessary that all evil people will have done just bad karma. That they may have done some good karma by which they get power in this world. But then they have some evil karma also because of which they have some evil tendencies. And it's not necessary that they have to be evil in this world. They sometimes choose that also. Sometimes it says that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So, if somebody is evil, that indicates that they have done some bad karma in the past. And if somebody is in an influential position or has got an influential birth, that also means that they must have done some good in the past because of which they have got an influential position now. So, it's not black and white, it's a combination of both. Okay, why did Dronacharya teach Duryodhan if he had if he had evil tendency right from his childhood? Okay, there are multiple factors to be considered whenever any particular decision is to be made. Drona was a Brahmin who was passing by that kingdom, and then seeing his skill, the Bhishma engaged them to be the martial teacher of the Pandavas and the Kauravas. So in a sense you could say that he was employed by the Kuru dynasty. And in the Kuru dynasty there was both the Brahmanas, both the Pandavas and Kauravas were there. There are certain characters in the Mahabharata who are white, certain characters who are black. But the Mahabharata is very clear in depicting characters in such a way that most of its characters are not entirely white and most of its characters are not entirely black. Many of them have, many of the good characters also have some moments of moral imperfection, or they have some moral flaws, or you could say moral weakness. So you could say that character like Drona and Bhishma, at one level you can say at a transcendental level whatever they did was a part of the plan of the Lord. But that's one way of, if you want to look at it from an ethical point of view, then you could say that some of the decisions they made were not necessarily the most right decisions. See, everything that is in scripture is not a teaching of scripture. In scripture there is something which is prescriptive and there is something which is descriptive. Prescriptive means this is what you need to do. But descriptive, this is what was done at that time. So now Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita says, Sa kaleneha mahata yoga nashta parantapa. That Krishna says, that ancient teaching of yoga and dharma, which has been going on since time immemorial, that has gradually over time become lost. And now I have come to give the knowledge by which it will become re-established again. Now what this means is, Krishna is saying that at his times, the existing condition is not necessarily fully dharmic, and he has come to establish dharma. So the society that is depicted in the Mahabharata is not necessarily an ideal society, and the actions of the characters in the Mahabharata are not necessarily all ideal actions. So Drona, we could say at one level, because he was employed by the Kuru dynasty, so he was obliged to teach all of them, and he couldn't avoid that teaching. Having said that, overall they had decided, I mean you could say that Dhritarashtra had decided and everybody had consented. When Duryodhana was born itself, there were many inauspicious signs, omens, which indicated that maybe this child is not a good child. And Vidura had told him that, you know, just abandon this child and you will still have 99 children. And with them you can live and you will be, things will be fine with that. But he refused to listen to that. So then, when the king had made the decision, then more or less the whole kingdom decided that he needs to be given a fair chance. There might, it's not just because somebody is bad, doesn't mean they will always be bad. So they all tried in their own way to help Duryodhan make good choices. And Duryodhan had an evil tendency, and unfortunately for him, he also had a weak father. If his father had been firm and had curbed his tendencies at that time, then maybe the history could have been different. So we can say that that was Drona's, it was not a decision that really covered Drona with glory to give that education to Duryodhana. Okay. What is the original source of evil? Does it also come from Krishna? Yes and no. You could say that everything comes from Krishna, but everything is not a thing. What do I mean by everything is not a thing? It's like, say, this bulb is giving light. And now I have put a hand in the way of this bulb. Suppose this was the only bulb and there's no tubes over here. Then my shadow would be formed over here. Now, that shadow is also existing because that light is there. But you could say darkness is not a thing in itself. Darkness is simply the absence of light. So you could say light is also not a thing in the sense that you can physically grasp it. But say light is an energy. Light is an energy, but darkness is not an energy in itself. Darkness is the absence of light. So similarly, evil is basically the absence of God. Wherever God is absent, that is where the human tendency, the soul's desire for pleasure, very easily becomes misdirected. And once it is misdirected, then that desire starts going in the kind of directions which is determined by its association. And that way, the evil comes because the soul becomes disconnected from God and then desires to enjoy. And by contamination, those desires get solidified. So it's not that evil is a separate entity apart from God. Evil is simply when we fail to choose God, that's when we gravitate towards choices that tend towards evil. It's like if you have a multiple, I was in Melbourne and I was having a question answer session. So there's somebody asked this question that if God is good, then why are good choices so few and the bad options so many? So I said, that's how it always is in any multiple choice exam. So you consider five options, four are wrong, only one is right. So you could say now all the options come from the teacher only, but all the options don't take you to the teacher, or one option takes you to the teacher and the teacher is happy, and the other options take you to the teacher but you are unhappy at that time. The teacher is also unhappy. So basically, if it's not a matter of random chance which option is chosen, it's a matter of how much one has assimilated what the teacher has taught. Based on that we choose. So, in the world, the inability to choose God, the inability to choose the right option, that's what leads us to the end up with choosing the wrong options. And you could say among the wrong options, there can be different degrees of wrongness. Wrong is wrong, but you could say there are degrees of wrongness also sometimes. So, that way, evil is simply the absence of God, or the absence of a connection, the inability to connect with God or choose God, that leads to a downward spiral. So, some people say just live in the moment. Why bother about a purpose at all? How can we convince them to come to closer to Krishna? The capacity to trade the present for the future is the defining human characteristic. No other living being has this capacity. What do I mean? Trade the present for the future. We all have certain drives which come, say the drive to eat, the drive to sleep, the drive to mate, the drive to protect ourselves. These are drives which are there in all living beings, and all living beings fulfill those drives. Humans also do that. But we humans are capable of doing something more. That we can have this understanding that if I sacrifice some pleasure in the present, that can create a better future for me. So I can trade the present for the future. And any advancement that human beings have made in any field, that is based on this ability alone. Yesterday I gave the example of Newton seeing the fruit falling. Now, he could have just picked up the fruit and eaten that. But he didn't. He traded the present, the pleasure in the present of eating that apple, for the future. Oh, if I can understand this, that can lead to so much more knowledge and power through that knowledge. If we consider learning language, it's not easy to learn language. But when a child is just incoherently crying and laughing, its range of communication is so small. Now, to apply oneself to learn a language, it takes a lot of effort. But then once the language is learned, a whole universe of communication connection opens, which is no longer there before. So animals don't have this ability. They specifically to learn complex languages. They also have communication strategies among them. So every area that we humans have achieved anything worthwhile, it is by this willingness to trade the present for the future. So all of you are studying now, getting education. So what are you doing? Now you could be enjoying parties and you could be doing so many things. Some people might say youth is the time to enjoy. But those of you who are serious about creating a better life for yourself, you will turn away from those enjoyments and study. Apply yourselves so that you have a career and then you have a brighter future. Those who don't do that, so many students just drop out. And if they drop out, then afterward they just have to maybe work at some menial job and get some bare hand-to-mouth living. And not a very bright future. So if they are unwilling to trade the present for the future, then the future stays quite bleak. So now this principle itself is universal as far as human beings are concerned. To know that we can trade the present for the future. Now what spirituality tells us is that the future extends not just into the future in this life, but the future beyond this life into eternity. So when we sacrifice our present for the future, that is when we grow spiritually. So, you could just, rather than presenting spirituality as something which requires rejection of material life, say that the same principle that has enabled the advancement of knowledge and advancement of humanity in the material sphere, that same principle is expanded when we apply it to the spiritual sphere, to beyond this life. Can we remove our bad impressions which are obstacles in our spiritual life? Yeah, first thing is don't focus on removing them. Focus on connecting with Krishna. Because saying no to anything is always, it always feels like a deprivation. Oh, why can't I do this? Why can't I do this? So focus on saying yes to Krishna. The impressions inside can't be removed. Our memory does not come with a delete button. But those memories can be overwritten. So those impressions can be overwritten. So if we just focus on the present and engaging in committed devotional activities in the present, gradually those memories from the past will go so much into the background that they will no longer trouble us. It's just like I gave the example of Bollywood and Bhagavad-Gita in your browser. So if you keep choosing Bhagavad-Gita again and again and again and again and again, after some time when you type B, automatically Bhagavad Gita will come as autocomplete. So just don't worry so much about the past impressions. Just focus on the present and try to create good impressions in the present. And even in the present, don't think in terms of, okay, in the rest of my life, I will never do this. Don't think in those terms. Just think that, okay, for this next one day, let me try to live as purely as I can. For the next 1 hour, let me avoid these weaknesses. And just take your hand. If you are able to do it for 30 days and 31st days, you relapse. Don't beat yourself up for having a relapse in 31st day. Just thank Krishna, appreciate yourself that you are able to do this for 30 days. Take that as a sense of your, take that as a confidence booster and resume. Ultimately, it is Krishna's purpose is not to catch us when we do wrong. Hey, you did wrong, I caught you now. Krishna's purpose is to catch us when we fall. He's there with us, within us, to help us. So to catch us when we fall. So it's like a small child is learning to walk and a mother watches from a distance. Hey, come on, walk, walk, walk. And the child falls, the mother doesn't start clapping. Hey, you fell down. The mother runs and catches the child. And helps the child rise again. So Krishna is not a fault-finding God. He's compassionate, he's merciful. Of course, he wants us to grow and there are consequences of the wrong choices, but we shouldn't focus so much on giving up the past wrong things. Focus on doing the on connecting with the right things in the present, and gradually those connections will become new impressions which will remove the older impressions. How to become simple and committed? Even I don't know that. I am also very complicated and uncommitted right now. But two, three things I can say is start with simple things. We can say that means in our spiritual life, we consider spiritual life to be a big circle. There are some things which you will be naturally attracted to. And there are some things which you don't mind doing. Okay, I can do it. And some things you find very difficult to do. So sometimes you may just reduce spiritual life. Oh, I have to do this every day. Some devotees may find waking up in the morning very difficult. Some devotees may find maybe chanting very difficult. Whatever it is. So don't reduce spiritual life only to the things which you find difficult to do. Find what you naturally connect with and try to do that as much as you can in your spare time, and try to get a taste for that, get a sense of success in that. Try to get some contribution which you can make through that. So once you do that, that will become the stable connection. And then once that becomes the stable connection, that stability will percolate to the other side also. So don't try to, means focus on committing at one area first. Yena kena prakaranga mana Krishna niveshaya. They said somehow or the other, fix the mind on Krishna. So start with first things first. Then over a period of time, it's another thing which we could do is try to associate with like-minded devotees. Somebody who understands you, whom you can understand. And that will also inspire you to move forwards. And thirdly, is try to have some kind of spiritual, if you have a spiritual guide, open your heart to them and explain what are your challenges. And then take some guidance about how you can move forward the best in your situation. Sometimes it might be like we are just taking baby steps. And that's all we can do. And if we try to take giant steps, when all that we can do is take baby steps, we will discourage ourselves because we will simply fall down and try to take giant steps. But sometimes we can take bigger steps, but we are still taking only small steps. So having guidance is very helpful to help us understand what is the best way we can move forwards. Can you please share your most valuable realization? It's difficult because I don't know if I have any realizations at all. So it's like asking, what is your most valuable zero? So I don't know, but recently I was in USA. At that time, one Mataji, she said she wanted to meet me, and she had come with her son, a small boy, maybe 4-year-old boy. And then she told me that she was from a pious Hindu family, and she had married a boy. She also wanted to, she was from a religious family. She said, I wanted to marry a boy also who is religious. So I met this devotee in my office, who was a devotee, and I thought he was very serious and committed about spiritual life. So then we got married. But afterwards I found that he was a very short-tempered person. Would speak harshly, and sometimes I would live in constant fear. So then she said that 4 years ago, this was in a city in America, she said I had come there for a class, and she along with her husband had come for my class. And she said at that time my husband heard your class and he was very inspired by that. And he says, and so I mentioned earlier that I write Gita daily every day. So he said from that day onwards, every single day he reads your Gita articles, and I can see that his anger is gone down. Every time when he becomes tense now, I can see that he's going to get angry, I immediately open my phone, open Gita daily and give it to him. So now he started doing it himself. But he says, just by reading about the Gita every day, hey, he says my life has become so much more peaceful, so much happier, and he has changed dramatically. So he was practicing bhakti for 5-6 years before, but he said that this has affected him tremendously. So now I started Gita daily long ago, maybe 8 years ago. It was completely circumstantial. Circumstantial means that you might have noticed that I need crutches for walking. So I have polio, but I had that since I was one, but in 2011 I slipped and had a fracture in the same leg where I had polio. So after that the doctor told me that you shouldn't travel anymore. Of course, fortunately I recovered afterward and I'm able to travel, but at that time for a year or so I didn't travel at all, maybe 2-3 years almost. So I was thinking I needed some service and I had a strong desire to share. So because I couldn't travel and speak, so I decided to start this Gita daily at that time. It is primarily because I didn't, you could say, I was unemployed. So I thought I loved the Gita and I loved to play with words. So I just tried to bring the two together and started writing something. And at that time I had no idea. I had tried many things, many different services, and it's not that every service works out. So when I started it at that time, I had no idea whether I would continue it for 1 month or 1 year or whatever. But somehow I started it, it's going on, and whichever part of the world I go, even a part of the world where I have never gone, now there are devotees who come and meet me, and new people also come and meet me, and they say, we read this Gita daily, we like it, and we find it beneficial. So I get this particular experience was, of course, by, you could say, among the most moving testimonies for me. And it's not that I am writing anything special, earth-shaking kind of insights. I'm just taking the basic principles of the Bhagavad Gita and explaining them in contemporary language with contemporary examples. So it struck, after this particular interaction, struck me that when we try to do something good, it is how we may be used for that purpose is something which even we can't conceive. So basically, sometimes we feel my existence is so insignificant. What can I do? The world is such a big place, and what change can I make in this world? But when we think like this, one way to avoid that feeling of helplessness or hopelessness is to understand that, okay, I'm insignificant, but can I make things worse? Some of you may be in a bad situation in your life, but can you make your situation worse? Yes. No situation is so bad that it takes away your power to make it worse. Is it? You might get a fracture and you might be bedridden for the next 6 weeks. You can take a hammer and fracture your other leg also. So, if no situation is so bad that you can't make it worse, then that means you are not as powerless as you think. That means that if we can make things worse, that means we can make things better also. And how much better? None of us knows that. Now, if we put our act together and we try to do our best, how much good we can do in the world, we ourselves don't know the limit of that. So discovering how much good we can do if we put our act together. Put our act together means we just try to do the best that we can. Instead of just worrying about this, getting angry about that, getting distracted by that. Just put our act together and do our best. Then discovering how much good we can do, that can be our life's greatest adventure. So discovering how much good we can do, if we try to connect with Krishna and serve Him, that is life's ultimate adventure. So that is one of my most inspiring experiences that I have had. I don't know whether I can call it a realization, but that is a moving experience for me. So my brother was my role model, and he was exemplary in many ways, but he got into bad association. He became addicted to drugs, and my mother and siblings, we all consoled him, and he stopped some of the things. How can I help him to give up everything, give up all kinds of drugs? It's a difficult situation. I'd say two different things over here. First is that we have to understand that we can only help the unable, not the unwilling. What is the difference between the unable and the unwilling? So suppose you are driving a car and the car doesn't start. Then what happens? Maybe you call some people nearby and they push the car. And they push from outside and you are trying to maneuver from inside. And then the car moves. But suppose somebody's car is not moving and people are pushing from outside. But if that person is pressing the brakes from inside, then people are saying, why should we push? Or the person inside has gone to sleep. Then there's no point in pushing. So we can only help the unable, not the unwilling. That doesn't mean that we abandon somebody, but everybody has their own journey to go through. So don't take, if somebody rebuffs your attempt to help you, don't take it too personally, because everybody is going through a lot in their head, and it's like in everybody's head a movie is going on, and in that movie they are the stars and everyone else is an extra. So what they do with others, even if they hurt others a lot, they are dealing primarily with the issues in their own head. So sometimes you need to not take others' actions too personally. If they don't accept your help, don't take it as a personal failure. And when you, although it's a very close, it can be a close relationship, there has to be a certain amount of detachment to keep perspective. And so why is this perspective needed? Because sometimes whenever there is addiction, there is a phenomenon called codependency. Codependency means that those who love that addict, maybe their spouse or their siblings or their parents, they want to help the person, but somehow they act in a way by which they unwittingly further the addiction. Say somebody is an alcoholic and that person makes a big scene, and then immediately the relatives come and conceal the whole thing, or they tell you they fainted, he's not well, or something like that. Basically, they shield the person from the consequences of the actions. And sometimes that is the worst thing that you can do for them. Because if somebody is unwilling to change, then sometimes they need a jolt. That means we have to stop shielding them from the consequences of their actions. When the consequences hit them, this is not what I want for my life. And then they will become, move from unwilling to unable. So if somebody is unwilling to change, then you have to stop shielding them from the consequences of their actions. Now if they are unable, then we have to understand what we are able to do. Basically, one human being can influence another human being in primarily three ways. Provide knowledge, provide facilities, and provide inspiring example. That means, provide knowledge means that, okay, if you do this, this is the result. If you do this, this is the result. Don't just tell, don't do this. Because that just seems like an imposition, but provide knowledge. Maybe show some videos of what is the effect of drug addiction. Take them to some seminars where they can actually, or some places where they can interact. Basically, provide knowledge. And sometimes it's very best that rather than you giving a lecture, let somebody, some authority whom they may respect, let them speak. Maybe through videos or something like that. So provide knowledge of the consequence of their choices. And sometimes when people see, that itself they sober up. Second is provide facilities. Facilities means, many times when somebody is not able to do something, we think it's a willpower issue. But it's not just a willpower issue. It's also a situation issue. In certain situations, it's almost impractical and impossible to expect willpower to be exercised. I suppose somebody is an alcoholic and their house is on top of a bar. And they decide, now I'm going to give up drinking alcohol. And how likely are they to be successful? It's you know, the urge, like I said, the urges come. And one thing that needs to be done when the urges come high, that there has to be some distance between us and the object of indulgence. Distance can be physical, distance can be practical. Basically, it should not be very easily available for us to indulge. When that happens, then we are able to make sure then that distance or obstacle between the two can help the person to come back to their senses before they succumb. Sometimes if there are particular kinds of withdrawal symptoms that are coming because of their addiction, they try to help them to go through dark periods. You come back, you can just ask them, instead of telling them don't do this, just ask them itself, how can I help you deal with this? But provide facilities so that they can make healthier choices. Now, one important facility could be that you give them some facility to connect with Krishna, not necessarily in a preachy sense, but maybe just spiritual music, some spiritual images, maybe some spiritual literature. I just invite them to come to a spiritual trip, maybe to Vrindavan, to Mayapur. Or take them to some place where they get exposed to experience the joy of spirituality. And then maybe this is what I want more in my life. So, facilities. And third is an example. Example means so it's basically like which way one should go, the facility to go along that way, and the inspiration to go along that way. So, if in their times of need, we are there to help them, if they can see that despite the difficulties that we are going through or others are going through, still we stay unflinching and we support them, then that itself can be an example for them. So if they see that you are committed to your spiritual practices and your spiritual practices are making you a better human being, we all have certain defects, and if our spiritual practices help us to overcome those defects, and that indicates that things are working for us. That this process is making a difference for us. And if they see that difference being made in our lives, they will also be inspired to also take their prospects. So that way you can help them. Can we achieve higher stages of devotion in a very short while? I feel that it's a good desire to have, to advance very fast in bhakti. But we have to understand that the essence of devotion is the connection with Krishna. It's not that advancement is like a competitive sprint in which you have to go faster than others. It's more that try to connect with Krishna and dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. Krishna will give the intelligence about how best, at what pace, in what way one can advance. So if we consider that the soul is eternal, if we consider that we have been here for many, many lifetimes, then what we are doing in this lifetime is already quite fast. The kind of transformation that we are going through, it is significantly fast. And it will increase as we keep practicing bhakti. Okay. That's all now. Okay. So, if we commit sin and then we get the reaction, does the person who is the medium for giving us that reaction also get sin? If so, then how do you understand that karma is for reformation, not punishment? Okay. Everything has to be understood in its proper context. I was in America. There are different ways of presenting Krishna consciousness. Some people present Krishna consciousness, even devotees also, sometimes they present in a very negative way. So negative means now, Prabhupada hardly ever present like that. If you do this wrong, you're going to go to hell. Prabhupada hardly ever talks about that fear-centered practice of spirituality. So before I had gone there, some person I had told, had given a class over there, he had said that anybody who kills cows, anybody, beef is quite common in the Western world, even India also. In fact, I heard India is the world's biggest beef exporter, tragically speaking. So, but anybody who kills cow, that person will themselves be killed. They will become a cow and they will be slaughtered. And many, many more times like that. So then this person in the audience, sometimes people's intelligence works in perverse ways. So he said that if cow slaughterers become cows, then that means all the cows now were cow slaughterers in the past. So what's wrong in slaughtering them? So this is called in logic the error of the antecedent. The error of the antecedent means what? If A, then B. Therefore B, so A. It's like that. If it rains, the pavement will be wet. If A, then B. So today morning I wake up and go out and the pavement is wet. Therefore I say it must have rained yesterday. Is that necessary? No. Why? Because you have not shown that B is the only cause of A. So it could be that maybe there's a leakage in the drainage and that's why the water has got, the pavement has got flooded. Maybe somebody was carrying some buckets of water and then the water spilled. Maybe somebody was watering the lawn and some water spilled over. So if A then B does not mean if B then A. So we generally have to look at people from this life's perspective. From this life's perspective means, from this life's perspective, the cow is considered like a second mother. Because we drink cow's milk and cows are so tender and gentle. So to kill them is brutal. And cow slaughterers are doing brutal things. So when something wrong is happening in this world, from this world's perspective, we don't necessarily have to bring in the previous life over there. The cow slaughterer who is killing a cow, that cow slaughterer is not thinking, I was a cow in a previous life and this was a slaughter and I want to kill them. That cow slaughterer is only thinking, this is the way I am going to earn my money. So they have no intention of, not even knowledge, that they are trying to give somebody their karma. So if we get some reaction right now to something which we have done, then how do we respond to that? There are two, three different perspectives over here. It depends on what exactly is being done to us and by whom. So it's like if the police punish a wrongdoer, then that's the way justice and the rule of law are mentioned, maintained. But there is something called vigilante justice. Vigilante justice is where some people take the law in their own hands and then they decide these persons are the criminals and they need to be killed. Now, vigilante justice in movies might seem very dramatic, but if people started doing that, taking the law in their own hands, society, social order would crumble very easily. That's not something which should be encouraged. So, we have to consider not what this person's past karma is, or if we are the brunt of it, what should be considered is not whether this person is giving me my karma, we should be considered what is my dharma right now. What is my dharma right now? What is the right thing for me to do in this situation? So otherwise, you know, where do you stop this? Say if a mother has a newborn baby and the baby is crying, should the mother think, oh, this baby is crying because of some past karma? What would happen to maternal love at that time? The baby should, mother should think that this is my baby, it's my dharma to take care of the baby. So we can't let suffering people stay suffering, especially if it's our dharma to help them at that time. And similarly, If somebody is causing us suffering, then we have to see what is my dharma in this situation. Dharma means we have to have a sense of perspective, what is more important and what is less important. I have a whole seminar on this, but I'll quickly condense it. I say basically that there are three options whenever somebody is troubling us. Say, okay, if I had done something wrong, and I need to get some reaction. Now, if I can make out clearly, okay, this is wrong and this is a disciplinary action that is being taken against me, I can accept it. But if we are put in a difficult situation and we have three options, tolerate, mitigate or emigrate. So what does that mean? So suppose you are in local and it's a fifth, the compartment has 50 capacity and there are 300 people in that local. So everybody is squeezed together. And then in every group of people there are always some bullies. So say somebody is just pushing you. I have a lot of strength. So they start pushing you. And you think, who do you think you are? You have a lot of strength, I also have a lot of strength. And you push them back. And they push you. And you push them. And they push you. And you push them. And you get so caught in pushing and counter pushing that your station comes and goes and you're still pushing. You say, that is foolish, isn't it? So, okay. Say, here, what is the purpose? What is your purpose in getting on that train? It is not to occupy that particular place. It is to get to your destination. So, as compared to your purpose of getting to your destination, where you stand is a small thing. So, okay, you want to boss around, I don't care. You just move somewhere else. It's just a 15-minute, half an hour journey. I'll get to my destination soon. And it will be over. That's one way of looking at things. So just keep small things small by focusing on the big thing. So, if somebody is troubling us, but it's a small thing, and we are still able to do the important thing in our life, just keep it small, let it get over. So, in this way, okay, now of course, in this example, we had not done anything wrong, but I'm just talking about, we are facing some difficulty, how do we respond to that? So, even if that difficulty is a reaction to some past karma which we have done, okay, I tolerate it, and it's over. But suppose that person starts pushing us out of the train itself. Then we can't tolerate that, isn't it? Why not? Because that is interfering with our big thing. Our purpose is to get to the destination. Then we have two options. Either we mitigate, then we maybe call to some other people or speak to that person, take assertive stand and stay over there. Or we might decide, I don't want to get into an argument over there. We might emigrate. Let's go to some other bogey. Okay? So sometimes, say, even if we have done something wrong and some reaction is given to us for that. But if that reaction is troubling us so much that we can't even live our life normally and properly, then we need to take a stand against it. We may have to emigrate or we may have to mitigate. So when difficulties come in our life, the principle of reformation occurs where we understand that I need to focus on the big things in my life and I need to move along the path that will take me to those big things. And small things, let me try to adjust them. So if we forget that, then what will happen is, that person does something to us and we do something to that person and these things just go on and on and on. Then it will just become an increasingly complicated kind of situation. So by focusing on the big thing, we can decide whether to tolerate, mitigate or emigrate. Okay. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada, okay, you have a question? Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry?
She was getting certain because of her past reaction or there was any external cause.
We don't know. So is it that a cow is slaughtered because of that cow's past karma? The law of karma is gahana karmano gati, Krishna says. It's complicated. And sometimes certain examples are given to illustrate how the law of karma works. But that doesn't mean that the law of karma has to work only in that way alone. What do I mean by this? That, see, our karmic record is spotted. That means we all have done some good karma, some bad karma. And although we would like to say that the principle of karma is that to every action there is a reaction, but sometimes it could be that to one action there might be a reaction that goes on for a lifetime. So then it's like, say somebody is born blind, then that is something which they have to suffer throughout their life. So is that for some one action they did in their previous life, or is that like a cumulative reaction for many actions that they have done in the past? That sense of proportionality, that is something which is worked out by the cosmic principles of justice. We don't know exactly how it works, because it's just too complex. But what we do understand is that the principle of accountability. So now, to illustrate that principle of accountability, some examples are given. So it is a possible trajectory that a person who, in the Puranas, there are some stories like that also, that a person who kills a cow, that person becomes themselves a cow and they are also killed. So there are at least one story I know in the Padma Puranas is like that. But that doesn't mean every single case of karmic accountability has to go along that trajectory alone. There can be different pathways. Just like, say, if a person is charged for crime. Now somebody might have been, that this person was charged for robbery. Okay, but while doing robbery, that person injured somebody else also. That somebody in a scuffle unintentionally killed someone. So what has happened is, there's one crime, but along with that there are many other crimes also. So sometimes a person is convicted for multiple crimes. And it may be that, okay, for this you have got 5 year sentence, this you have got 6 month sentence, for this you have got 10 year sentence, and the justice might club it all together and you got 13 year sentence or 14 year sentence. So it sometimes may be that multiple sentences are combined together in a single sentence. So we don't really know exactly how karma works. So we'll all become very judgmental and very uncaring if we start looking at everything in terms of past karma. You know, that means, say, we are having some friendship with some devotee or some other person is a good person, and suddenly they get some terrible disease like cancer or some very bad accident they go through. Now should we start thinking, no, I thought you are a good person, but but the very fact that you got a terrible disease means you must have been a very bad person in the past. Now if we start thinking like that, what will happen to all human compassion? We shouldn't be thinking like that. If a child is born with a congenital disease, should the mother think, oh, this is must be a very sinful soul, that's why born with a congenital disease like that? That would be monstrously hard-hearted. So what the mother should think is that, what we should think, okay, this is a special child who needs more from me than others. I am more needed over here. This is an opportunity for me for service. It's an opportunity for me to express my devotion, my dutifulness. So we have to see things in a way that is helpful for our consciousness, that is uplifting for our consciousness. Now that doesn't make us judgmental. Okay. How much time do we have to? Okay, one last question. If we are pursuing a particular purpose and then we along the path we find another purpose which is more appealing, so should we change our purpose and pursue the new purpose or the old purpose? life doesn't come with a guarantee of right decisions. We all have to take decisions based on the best intelligence that we have. And sometimes we make the right decisions, and sometimes we make the decisions right. That is that. Okay, I took this decision, and now let me make the best out of this decision. So if we try to think that at every step I am going to take the perfect decision, it will lead to paralysis by analysis. I was in Stanford, and after my talk over there, one American lady came to talk with me, and she said, my daughter is in Stanford, and she has been for 12 years in Stanford. I said, really? Is she doing PhD? No, she is in first year now. So I said, what happened? She said, she is a brilliant student, and she was always among the top 5 throughout her school and her initial college. I said, then what happened? She says, last 12 years, she is changing her major to find out what is her calling. What is her calling? That means, like, somebody changes from, say, first year they do bachelor BE in electronics, then they shift to BE in mechanical, then they shift to BE in telecommunications, then they shift to BE in computer science. So that, like, 12 years she has been shifting her major. And she says now her co-students are already settled in careers and marriage, they're married, and she's still the first year. So then she was asking, what should I do? How can I inspire her? So then I gave her an overall simple framework. I said that. Then her daughter also came over there, so I talked to both of them. So I said that, it's the same point I said, you know, if we try to wait to make every decision perfect, we will not be able to ever make any decision. So in life, we cannot have perfect choices, we can have only optimal choices. Optimal means the best in that situation. So we use our intelligence, God-given intelligence that we have, and generally if it's a major decision in our life, it's good to write things down. Okay, this was why I was planning to do this, but now this is why I want to do this. And then basically, as long as thoughts are inside our head, they congest us. It's like a constantly thoughts are going on and on and on and just congesting. But get the thoughts out. Feel some relief by that. And then, to get the thoughts out, some distance is created. Then maybe a day after that, look at everything. This is like this, this is like this. And based on that, you could say, okay, at right this stage, this is this weighs more, this weighs less. And then you may decide, I have 3 months or 6 months, if it's a major decision, I have 3 months to take this decision. And you might decide every week, I'll spend 1 hour on analyzing this deeply. Basically, what you're trying to do is, through by this process, you're trying to make your intelligence the counselor of your mind. Your mind is there, mind is saying, oh, let's do this. Oh, no, let's do that. But what about that? What about that? The mind is like a child having so many voices. Now, like a child also has to be heard. But the child cannot be expected to take the decision and to commit to the decision. The parent has to guide, so the intelligence has to be like the parent, like the counselor. So, okay, let the child have his say. Write down everything that you have feel about it. And then, generally, if we have some complicated issue to think about, then thinking about it while we are in the rush of life, maybe catching this bus or going here, going there, thinking about it when we are actively running around, it just doesn't work. It simply drains and burdens us. So decide that I'm not going to think about it, and if some new thought about that comes up, then just note it down, don't think much about it. And then at the end of the week, when you decide maybe 1 hour I'm going to spend on this, so look through everything and maybe pray about it, chant a few rounds, and then look through it carefully, and then say, okay, this is important. I didn't think about this. Just add to that. Basically, when you first wrote everything down, you got a snapshot of your mind. And now, you are refining that picture more and more, making it more and more clear. And so, every week you do that, and then sometimes you may find, okay, initially I was thinking like this, but actually there are a lot of factors in this that I didn't think about. And then after 6 months, if that's the time you have decided, then you decide, okay, this were the, these are the factors here, these are the factors here, this seems stronger, so I'm going to go along this. Now when you go along that, the mind, even after we take a decision, has a tendency to second guess. Oh, maybe I shouldn't have done this, maybe I should have done that. That can be, that can just eat away our enthusiasm. So then at that time, if you have things written down, now based on the knowledge that I had, this was the decision I took, and this was the best I could have taken, then you'll be able to stay committed without being sabotaged by your mind. And sometimes suddenly a new information comes up, and then you realize, you know, this new information is so disorienting, it changes the whole equation completely. Then maybe in the light of this new information or this new change, I think that this decision is not going to work, I may have to change it. So then you might want to go back earlier, but then it won't be just on the whims of the mind. It will be, so if you are going to make a course correction also, it will be well thought, you will have a basis for doing that. So this be, so that through the, if you do this, what you are doing is, there's no guarantee that even through this you will get the decision right. Because sometimes a decision seems right at point A, but at time A, but after maybe 6 months you find out this was not the best decision. Because new light, new things come to light. So we can't always get the decision right, but we can try to get the decision making process as right as possible. And if you got the decision making process right, then we will know how to push through a decision even when you don't feel like it, and when to do course correction. Okay. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Tai Gaur Premanande. Yeah.